on-demand provisioning of workflow middleware and services. An overview.
Together and welcome to my presentation of our on-demand provisioning of workflow middleware and services. My name is Katharina Bukowicz-Haupt. I'm working at the Institute of Architecture of Application Systems at the University of Stuttgart. And in this presentation, I want to show some topics of my dissertation.
A user wants a workflow on his local system.
and the workflow middleware and the services are not running at this time. After that, the user starts the workflow execution with only one click. And everything else is handled invisibly and automatically in the background. In the first step, the provisioning engine is provisioned into cloud infrastructure. And the provisioning engine, this is a component which is able to provision service into cloud. In the next step, the provisioning engine provisions the workflow middleware into the cloud, including the underlying infrastructure. Then the workflow is deployed in this middleware and instantiated. And every time when the workflow calls a service, the provisioning engine first has to provision the service, including the underlying middleware and infrastructure, into the cloud. To be able to do this, the provisioning engine needs a so-called service package. And the service package, this is a component which contains all artifacts needed to provision the service. And one example can be the description of this topology of the service, or the implementations of the component of the service, or the description of the provisioning process. That means in which order we have to provision the components and connect them together. And if a service is not needed anymore, the provisioning engine deprovisions the service, including the underlying middleware infrastructure. And similarly, when the workflow execution is finished, then the provisioning engine deprovisions the workflow middleware, including the underlying infrastructure. And finally, the provisioning engine itself is deprovisioned. Let's summarize. With our on-demand provisioning approach, the users can run the simulation workflows in the cloud with only one click. And local on the user's system, we have only a modeling tool and a so-called bootware. And this bootware, this is a small piece of software which triggers the on-demand provisioning process. The middleware, the workflow middleware, and the services are provisioned on demand. In our approach, we are exploiting the cloud characteristics, and we are reusing existing provisioning technologies. And by that, we can optimize resource allocation. Installing and running the workflow middleware and the services is handled invisibly and automatically in the background. Okay. As an underpinning for our concept of on-demand provisioning, we introduce an extended justification for service buying strategies. In the upper part, you see an example workflow. And in the middle, you see an enterprise service bus. And this is a component which is able to realize different service buying strategies. The first strategy is called static binding. In this strategy, the service call already contains the endpoint of the service. And DSB only forwards the service call to this endpoint. The next strategy is called dynamic binding. In this strategy, and for all the following strategies, the service call only contains a description of the functional and non-functional requirements of the service call, but no specific endpoint. When receiving a service call, DSB first has to carry out a service discovery and a service selection, find a suitable service which fulfill the functional and the non-functional requirements. And then DSP forwards the service call to the endpoint of the just selected service. The service strategy is called dynamic binding, the service deployment. When receiving a service call, the ESP first has to determine a matching service implementation, and then it deploys the service implementation on an already existing and suitable middleware. Then the ESP forwards the service call to the endpoint of the just deployed service. For our on-demand provisioning approach, we defined a new service binding strategy, the so-called dynamic binding the service stack provisioning. When receiving a service call, DSP also has to carry out a service discovery and a service selection. But the result is not a specific endpoint, it is a specific service package. And we use the service package to provision the service into the cloud. First, we provision the needed infrastructure and the middleware, and then on top of this, our service implementation. Then the ESP forwards the service call to the endpoint of the just provisioned service. And in this service binding strategy, we provision the whole software stack. In our previous work, we developed an architecture based on this binding strategy. But our architecture also supports static binding and dynamic. To clearly distinguish between services which are provisioned on demand with an always-on semantic and services which are provisioned on demand, services which are provisioned in advance and services which are provisioned on demand. In the following, we will call them provision services and not provision services. The concept of non-provision services and the combination with the provision services leads to new challenges. We need a new service selection process which supports both provision services as well as non-provision services. And in the next slides, I will show you our solution for these challenges. Okay. Which realizes the service binding. This component is a workflow engine which is responsible to execute workflows. And here we have the enterprise service bus which coordinates the processing of the service call. Then we have a service registry. This is a global directory which contains information about all services, provisioned services as well as non-provisioned services. And for every provisioned service in the service registry, the service package repository, also a global directory, contains the corresponding service package. And in addition, provisioning metadata. The provisioning manager, this is a component which is able to provision service packages in different service package formats like Chef or Tosca or Juju or Puppet in different cloud infrastructures. Okay, let's start with the process. The service calls are initiated by the workflow engine, and a service call contains the actual payload as well as different metadata. The non-functional requirements describe the interface of the service, the functional requirements describe the quality of service, and whereas these metadata, these requirements correspond to traditional service-oriented computing concepts, the provisioning requirements These are specific for our on-demand provisioning approach. The provisioning requirements are specific for the provisioning process. An example for a provisioning requirement can be cloud providers or a region where such a service package has to be provisioned. Okay, when receiving a service call, the enterprise service bus has to carry out a service discovery and a service selection. First, the service registry finds the services which fulfill the function requirements. And in the next step, the service registry finds the service which also fulfill the non-function requirements. And when the result set of this service selection contains at least one provision service, then the service selection step returns exactly one endpoint of a provision service. And the enterprise service bus forwards the service call to this endpoint. But when the service selection result set does not contain any provision service, then for every non-provision service, for every service candidate which is a non-provision service, the service selection step returns a service package reference. And DSB forwards the set of service package references together with the provisioning requirements of the service call to the provisioning manager. And then the provisioning manager carries out a service package selection by forwarding the set of service package references together with the provisioning requirements of the service call and the provisioning capabilities, its own provisioning capabilities to the service package repository. And now the service package repository has to find a service which on the one hand fulfill the provisioning requirements of the service call and which on the other hand can be processed by one of the provisioning engines of the provisioning manager. And now we take the service package to provision the service. That means we first provision the infrastructure and the middleware, and on top of this, the service implementation. And in the last step, the enterprise service bus forwards the service call to the endpoint of the just provision service. When we designed our service selection and our service package selection process, one of our goals was to achieve a separation of concerns. As you can see, the enterprise service bus and the service registry, they are together responsible to perform the service selection and routing. And the only thing new in this part is that in sometimes the service selection step does not result in an endpoint of a provision service, but in a set of service package references which are forwarded from the enterprise service bus to the provision. And all the provisioning related functionality, like the service package selection and the provisioning of the service, is handled by the provisioning manager together with the service package repository. Our provisioning manager is designed to be extensible. We want to that the provisioning manager is able to support a lot of cloud infrastructures and a lot of different service package formats, like mentioned before, Shushu, Chosco, and so on. The reason is that we find in the web a lot of already existing service packages, and we can reuse it. And there are the corresponding community for Chef and so on. Okay. In traditional SOC scenarios, in traditional service-oriented computing scenarios and in our on-demand provisioning approach. A service consumer assumes that the service is always on and available. That means, in general, the introduction of our on-demand provisioning approach doesn't influence the service consumer. The reason is that the technical complexity of our on-demand provisioning system is handled invisibly and automatically in the background. However, we assume that the additional time that we need to provision a service has no negative impact to the service consumer. And in the science domain, where the simulation services are typically long-running, this is a good assumption. Okay. And in the following, I want to show you a comparison of the differences in service binding in traditional service-oriented computing scenarios and in our on-demand provisioning approach. And from now on, when I say traditional service-oriented computing scenarios, when I say SOC, then I mean service-oriented computing scenarios. And when I say ODP, then I mean our on-demand provisioning approach. Okay. How we can publish a service in SOC. A service provider registers a service by providing its functional, non-functional capabilities as well as the endpoint of the service. And all the services that are registered are provisioned in advance. Yeah? Okay. And in ODP, when we want to publish a service, this needs two steps and two rules. In the first step, the service package provider registers the service package in the service package repository by providing its provisioning capabilities. And in the next step, it also registers the corresponding service offer in the service registry by providing its functional capabilities, its non-functional capabilities, and a reference, a service package reference to the corresponding service package in the service package repository. And every time a service provider provisions the service, it also registers the endpoint of the just provision service in the service registry. And when the service has done its work, the service provider deprovisioned the service and removed the endpoint in the service registry.
Functional and non-functional requirements, and in addition, the provisioning requirements.
And the ODP middleware carries out a service package selection to find the suitable service package and provisions then first the corresponding service into a cloud infrastructure. And after that, it can forward the service call to the endpoint of the just provision service. And after the service process, the service call, it sends a response to the ODP middleware, and the ODP middleware forwards the service response to the service consumer. And in the last step, the ODP middleware deprovisions the service. Now I want to show a short summary about the differences in service binding and SOC and ODP based on the well-known published find by operations. Okay, the main difference of SOC and ODP in the published step is that in the SOC registers a service and provides an endpoint. And the ODP approach provides a service package reference. In the find step, the SOC, in SOC we carries out the service selection, the service registry carries, performs the service selection, and in ODP we perform a service package selection. In the bind step, the service call in SOC is bind to an endpoint, and in ODP we first have to provision the service, and then we can bind the service call to this endpoint. Okay, let's summarize. In my presentation, I introduced our on-demand provisioning approach. With our approach, the users can run the simulation workflows in the run phase in the cloud with only one click. And the complexity of our system is hidden in the middleware, and the middleware this is an extended enterprise service bus. In our approach, we are exploiting the cloud characteristics and we are reusing existing provisioning technologies. And as we have seen in the presentation, our on-demand provisioning approach also leads to new challenges. And I have shown how we tackle these challenges. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, thank you. And please, we start with this. Yes.
Maybe I've missed the details, but I'm wondering about the interaction of the service binding step and the automatic provisioning, which looked like two separate components in your architecture, right? So what are your assumptions in terms of factoring in the cost of the provisioning into the selection step? Because if you need to deploy a workflow management system in the background and have it configured, then this may affect the selection of your selection component based on that cost. How does it relate? How do you even estimate the cost of doing the provisioning if it has to be factored in into the selection step?
You define this as, you can also define this as a function requirement, yeah? It depends.
So if you have a non-functional requirement based on the time it takes to run your workflow, right?
Yes.
Then how do you factor in that you need to first deploy the workflow management system? How do you know how long it takes to deploy it?
Okay. This is a good question. First we have to provision the workflow management system and then we start the workflow execution. But we only do the functional and non-functional requirements, define the non-functional and functional requirements for the services, yeah, but not for the workflow management system. The user defines provision requirements and functional requirements for the for local management system, and it defines functional requirements, non-functional requirements, and provisioning requirements for the services. We compare also the services together, but first we have to wait for the welfare management system. But in the e-science domain, it's so that the actual situation is that they use the grid system and they have to wait in a waiting list one day or some days, so that they can do their work, and so it's no problem.
Okay, thank you. Some more questions, please. With the microphone, if you wish.
Probably this is details now, but if you deploy a workflow management system, of course, or any kind of middleware, you need to tune the system according to certain performance parameters, usually, right?
Oh, I don't understand.
So if you require tuning your workflow environment, is that something that you consider also automatically as part of the deployment? This may be very much based on the workload that you anticipate. Do you have a standard profile for your scientific simulations, or are there variations possible?
You can describe the steps in the service package. This you can done with the provisioning language, the so-called provisioning language. In the provisioning language, you say what parameter, in which order, and something like this, you can do this. And a provisioning language, this is a formal language. And for this provisioning language, we have also a suitable, a corresponding provisioning engine. And this provisioning engine can then understand this language and can do this step by step. Yeah? And there are a lot of provisioning technologies created in the last year. Yeah?
Okay, no more questions?
Yeah, one more. Which cloud technologies did you use to run the workflows on, and how did you interact with those clouds?
Sorry, can you
The Scottish accent, sorry. The cloud platforms that you deployed the workflows to, and which cloud platforms did you use?
What kind of platform? At the moment, we have plugins we have a plugin architecture, and we have plugins for Amazon cloud infrastructure, and we have to provision service package formats in service package formats in Tosca or in Cloud Foundation. But we can extend this to other cloud infrastructures.
Thank you very much.
Okay, I don't see any other question. So we thank you again. And now we come to the last talk before the coffee break. And Marina will give this talk about a service-oriented approach for improving quality of life.